Random House Audio presents The Keeper's Son by Homer Hickam. Read for you by Mitchell Greenberg. Prologue. The old wicker rocker creaked as Josh pushed back and forth, his bare feet slapping against the boards of the piser. His chin rested on his chest, and his hands restlessly worked up and down the arms of the chair. Every minute seemed to last an hour, and it was only 9 in the morning. That meant there were nearly 10 unending hours until he could do what he had always wanted to do. Josh was not a boy who cared much for waiting, especially today. It was one of the most important days in his life. But first, darkness had to come. Today, September 12, 1924, Josh Thurlow would light the lamp in the Killakeet Lighthouse all by himself. At sea, the light would appear as a brilliant beam for precisely 2 3/4 seconds, with an equal period of darkness, each flash a warning of the deadly shoals offshore. To the north sat the lighthouses of Ocracoke, Hatteras, Bodie Island, and Currituck Beach. To the south was the lighthouse at Cape Lookout. Up and down the sandy islands off North Carolina, the lighthouse service had set up these great towers to warn vessels that they were passing through what had been called for centuries the graveyard of the Atlantic. Below the waves were the hundreds of ships' skeletons, put there by sudden storms bashing them against hidden shoals. But ships would be safe as long as they heeded the flashing towers, and as long as the keepers on those shores kept the light. Josh's father, Keeper Jack Thurlow, who'd gone up to Bodie Island to see the keeper there, had worried about leaving Josh alone, not only with the responsibility of lighting the lamp, but also having to tend to Jacob, his baby brother just turned 2. But, after all, Josh was 14 and had proved himself responsible since his mother had died, working around the lighthouse and helping raise Jacob. His brother was now playing in the sand in the shadow of the lighthouse. He was happy and knew how to entertain himself, sometimes to Josh's consternation. That very morning, he caught Jacob in the sun-drenched room his mother had called her art palace, playing with a spilled box of beach glass. The room was virtually untouched since Josh's mother had died during Jacob's birth, and Josh knew why. The keeper had once confessed the palace was the one spot in the house where he could still sense his wife's presence. Josh felt the same about the room. After he carried Jacob outside, he returned and sat down in his mother's chair and touched the implements of her art, the small pliers she'd used to bend the silver and gold wire, the beads, beach glass, and shells she had strung to make bracelets, anklets, brooches, necklaces, and pins. Josh had accompanied his mother on many expeditions up and down Killakeet in search of beach glass, pieces of broken bottles ground smooth by the surf and the sand. The rarest of all the beach glass was that off the Alexander Hamilton, a bark-rigged screw steamer that had fetched up on bar shoals, battered to pieces. Among its cargo had been a few boxes of a rare California wine called Rose of Sharon. Over the years, ruby-colored gems from the glass of the Rose of Sharon bottles had occasionally washed ashore. It was those pieces that Jacob had spilled. As he rocked, Josh occasionally glanced at the ocean and the seabirds flying past. His mother had run a bird hospital right there on the piser of the keeper's house. Not easy with more than a dozen cats on the premises. Josh missed his mother. He would visit her before he went up to light the lamp. The Thurlows had a family cemetery behind the keeper's house, and Josh wanted to tell his mother about getting to keep the light, and how Jacob was doing, and how much of her he could see in Jacob's face. Something small, drifting along on the blue water, caught Josh's eye. He thought it might be flotsam from the wreck of the Bertha Gaskill, which had gone down in a storm just off Hatteras that past winter. Ever since, her planks had been floating in, and a big section of her wheelhouse had come ashore near the Crossin House, the summer cottage of a rich Yankee family about a mile south of the lighthouse. The best way to see was to climb the tower and have a look with his father's binoculars. But he didn't want to leave Jacob alone. So he picked him up, carried him on his hip, and started up the spiral staircase. Jacob burbled happily and clutched Josh's shirt with his tiny hands. Josh climbed the steps until he reached the lantern room. He took the binoculars off a hook, shifted Jacob on his hip, and went out on the high parapet. The wind was especially strong atop the lighthouse. Jacob giggled and squirmed. Hang on to me and don't let go. It's a long way down. Josh looked at the dot on the ocean. It was a little boat. It had a blunt bow, square stern, a tiny cockpit, looked very fast, and Josh wanted it. The people of Killakeet had made their living for years fishing and by what they called wrecking, taking what the sea had stolen. Josh could imagine how proud he'd be to show his father the little boat he'd wrecked and how jealous the other boys would be. Look, Jacob, he said. See the boat? Josh noted the direction of drift and went back down the stairs. He wanted to hop in his father's workboat and give chase. But what to do with his brother? Jacob had been on the workboat many times. He was a Killakeet baby, after all, and loved the ocean. He would take Jacob with him. Josh steered the workboat through the breakers, and they were off. Jacob squealed with delight as they bounced through the waves. But once past the breakers, Josh realized it was more difficult to find the little boat than he'd thought. He stood up and couldn't see it. It was too low in the water, and his own sail blocked his view. He tacked back and forth, and Killakeet slid past him. Before long, he'd passed Miracle Point, 7 miles south of the lighthouse, and was out on open water. Then, there it was. Josh saw the little boat as a wave tossed it up. It was farther out than he expected. A little piece of the Gulf Stream must have drawn it east, and then north. Josh tacked toward it until he was in the stream, too. He felt that river of warm, tropical water grasp the workboat and knew he'd have to work to get out of it after he caught the little boat. He looked at the sun and realized it was already well past noon. I better catch her quick, he said to himself. He knew he had to get Jacob home and be ready at twilight to light the lamp. At last, he tacked up to the boat and got a hand on it. To his delight, it was just as pretty and special as he thought. It looked brand new, too, its hull painted a bright red. He inspected the new painter attached to its bow. Someone had tied it off, but not very well, and the sea had grabbed it. Now it belonged to Josh, and Jacob too. Josh took the little boat in tow, tying its painter to the workboat's stern. He checked the sun. We got to get back and light the lamp, Jacob, he said to his brother. Josh was worried what might happen if he didn't get back in time. His father would never trust him again, and true disaster might occur. Ships depended on the light, and they'd pile up on bar shoals without it. Josh had to hurry. It was difficult to steer across the stream, but he was confident he could do it. The wind picked up. There was a chop on the sea. Josh got up to adjust the sail. His back was turned, and to his horror, he heard a splash. Jacob had fallen in. The workboat was moving along, the wind behind it. The stream was carrying Jacob away. Josh dove in and swam as hard as he could. The stream carried him, and within a few strokes he had Jacob, who sputtered and cried. But now he had to catch the workboat. With Jacob in one arm, Josh swam after the two boats. He was a powerful swimmer, and even against the stream he managed to catch the stern of the little red boat. He grabbed her with one hand and lifted Jacob into the cockpit. Then Josh went hand over hand to the workboat and climbed aboard. He was exhausted from the swim and shaking from the terror of almost losing his brother. The wind was blowing even harder. Josh had to get to shore. The wind began to blow blister hard and it started to rain. Josh had to use every ounce of his strength just to keep his heading, but still he kept checking the towed boat. Then the wind piled into him, a terrific gust, and nearly knocked the workboat over. Josh was tossed out into the fast current. He came up swimming. The workboat had righted herself, and he climbed aboard and looked. The greatest horror he'd ever felt coursed through his body. The little red boat was gone. The new painter was tied off on the workboat, but the other end had come undone. Josh hadn't checked the knot. A landsman had probably tied it, some sort of granny knot that had come loose with all the bouncing around. The near knockdown had finished untying it and sent Jacob off on his own across the waves. Josh screamed desperately into the wind, I'll find you, Jacob! Then he set the sail, clutched the tiller, and began to turn the workboat around against the mighty stream. Part 1. Dosie Crossan led her big brown mare down the ramp of the Wednesday ferry from Moorhead City. She had left Killakeet Island a dozen years ago, a rich man's daughter, bright, cheerful, filled with boundless dreams. By November 1941, Dosey had lived through the Great Depression, put herself through college selling encyclopedias, and been fired from a New York publishing house for a lunch break that lasted 3 days. She had also loved too often and been loved back too seldom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.